Welcome, everyone. Well, and welcome to the third week of the African Parliamentarians Forum. Today, we're going to take up the topic of overseeing spending in the security sector. Defense spending is necessary, but it also comes at cost. As one former US president stated, quote, every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies, in the final sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed. The source of that quote was President Dwight Eisenhower, Republican and former general who commanded forces in World War II. I'd like us to keep that quote in mind as we proceed today. Just as a reminder, I'm Shannon Smith here with the Africa Center, and we are going to be joined by two distinguished speakers, Dr. Willene Johnson and Mr. Neil Cole. Budgets are all about trade-offs. Budgets, whether it's in your household or your nation, force you to make decisions about priorities. As members of parliament and those working with parliaments, that makes your jobs incredibly important, but also very difficult. Because spending in one category, including in defense and security, which are vital, does pull funding away from other urgent needs. So you want to do all you can to ensure that spending is necessary, responsible, and as transparent and accountable as possible. Acknowledging something is important does not mean that it's easy. As we've been discussing, there are a lot of barriers to carrying out oversight. The procurement, budgeting, allocation of resources, including staffing shortages, structural obstacles, and demands for secrecy in the name of security. Different systems provide different legislatures, varying types of authorities. A universal point, however, is the desire that public resources are well spent. One theme that has come up in our discussions in the first 2 weeks is the challenge of separating information that must truly be kept confidential for legitimate security reasons, and information that can and should be subject to legislative and public scrutiny. There's a set of global principles on national security and the right to information that were developed to assist parliamentarians and others that are known as the Swane principles, because they were developed in Swane, South Africa. They were based on consultations with over 500 experts from over 70 countries around the world, including many African representatives. When it comes to budgeting, these principles say that information needed for evaluating and controlling the expenditure of public funds, including gross overall budgets, major line items, and basic expenditure information should be public. They say that information needed for evaluating and controlling the expenditure of public funds, including gross budget items, major line items, and basic expenditure information should be public. And they also say that information about budget lines concerning weapons and other military systems should also be made available to the public. We'll include a link to these principles in the final list of recommended documents that we'll send to you after the program. But I wanted to offer it today as an example of a measuring stick for executive transparency. And even if currently the executive branch does not meet these standards, and it varies in every country in the world, and it's a challenge in every country in the world, having such a set of publicly recognized principles gives you a measuring stick to hold up. We've asked our speakers today to take a very practical and pragmatic look at these issues, and especially to consider interventions that could be made at a relatively low cost, or it could be carried out with even limited staffing and some of the other challenges we've discussed. Today, our speakers are Dr. Willene Johnson and Mr. Neil Cole. We've asked them to start our conversation with two presentations on the roles and tools of accountable security budgets and the continuing need in a democracy to pursue both transparency and security throughout the continuum of defense spending and implementation. Dr. Willene Johnson is a consultant whose work currently focuses on economics of peace building. She has facilitated workshops for African peacekeepers and conducts courses on economic reconstruction at the U.S. Institute of Peace. Dr. Johnson has worked extensively in Africa and was selected by President Clinton to serve as the U.S. Director at the Africa Development Bank. She has served as a member of the United Nations Committee for Development Policy and chair of the Sub-Saharan Africa Advisory Committee of the United States Export-Import Bank. She also has extensive experience in the Federal Reserve System. She holds degrees from Radcliffe College and St. John's University, as well as a doctorate in development economics from Columbia University. Our second speaker today, Mr. Neil Cole, currently serves as the Executive Secretary of the Collaborative Africa Budget Reform Initiative, or CABRI. CABRI is an intergovernmental organization that provides a platform for peer learning and exchange for approximately 30 African ministries of finance and planning. Its work covers fiscal and budget policy, budget transparency and accountability, and public debt management. In addition to his role there, Neil Cole has been a co-faculty member of the Harvard PFM Executive Training Course, and he has been a co-faculty member of the Harvard Ministerial Leadership Forum. He is also a part-time faculty member of the International Training Center of the International Labor Organization. Between 2001 and 2013, he worked for the National Treasury of South Africa in senior management positions in the Budget Office and in the International Economic Policy Divisions. The Collaborative Africa Budget Reform Initiative bases much of its work on three questions: what works, what doesn't, and under what circumstances? Those are very useful questions for all of us to ask about our own work and our own government structures. With that, we turn to our featured speakers. Dr. Johnson, will you get us started, please?
Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank the Africa Center for organizing this discussion about the role of parliaments in providing appropriate resources to meet the security challenge in facing African countries. Although the budget role of parliaments may vary from country to country, parliaments are uniquely placed to support appropriate responses to threats by considering the full range of government services that contribute to human security. I understand that your discussion in the last few weeks has made clear that Parliament has multiple roles in creating laws, in overseeing the functioning of other branches of government, and also in playing an active role in budget decisions. Referring to the document that you had, the backgrounder, on security sector reform that was produced by the Geneva Center for the Democratic Control of Armed Forces, you're well aware that the roles and responsibilities of the parliament vary by country, especially as they relate to budget powers. So that there are some parliaments who can only approve a budget, others that have the right to approve or reject. Other parliaments can actually amend budget proposals, and those with the greatest amount of direct power can actually draft counter proposals or initiate proposals for government spending. I have a sense, though, that even those whose responsibilities may appear to be limited can have a profound effect on the functioning of the government and of the budget. As an economist, I have in the back of my mind a question that I pose at each recommendation for budget expenditure. Is it effective? And is it efficient? As an economist, I understand if you spend the right amount of money at the right time for the right thing, you are increasing the opportunities and the possibilities of economic growth in your country. And so we're not only talking about issues that may relate to governance in terms of corruption. We're talking about fundamental management issues. And through that fundamental management issues, one can achieve the objectives that are outlined. Because there is such variation in responsibility and roles, I think it's important that we assess performance by adherence to a basic set of principles. As we learned from the words of General Eisenhower, later President Eisenhower, there's a principle called contestability, that all sectors must compete on an equal footing for funding during budget planning and formulation. And so when we're considering human security, we must consider the expenses on hospitals as well as the expenses on police or the military. At the same time, there are nearly a dozen principles that have been outlined by the World Bank in its Public Expenditure Management Handbook, which for the last 20 years has guided many of us who work on fiscal affairs. I won't go through all of them, but in addition to contestability, I feel that transparency and accountability are the most important for us today. And transparency is defined as decision makers should have all the relevant, and I'll say all the relevant and accurate information before them, and be aware of all the relevant issues when they make the decisions. These decisions and the basis of those decisions should be communicated to the public. And the principle of accountability means that decision makers are responsible for the exercise of the authority provided to them. But one cannot step back and only assess the performance of the parliament. The assessment must come from the function, from the perspective of the function of the entire government, not just how parliament fulfills its narrowly defined functions, but how it interacts with other branches of government and supports the overall functions of the government. You see that the security sector budget is in the outer rim. And that is done to convey the clear requirement that, the overall budget is in the outer rim, and the security sector budget is set within the overall budget. It's set within the overall budget, not only in terms of the budget cycle, but also in terms of all the principles that we just referred to. So it must fit within the context of the overall government budget, and the annual security sector budget cycle and process fit into the overall government budget process. With the points of engagement, and I think of those points of engagement being when we move from the outer circle to the inner circle, the points of engagement with the parliament are determined by the budget roles and responsibilities of the parliament. And I believe that Mr. Cole will give us some very practical examples of those interactions. What I'd like to do in just a few minutes is to walk us around that cycle, so that we can see how the relationship between the different parts of the budget, the overall budget and the security sector budget within it. If we look at the definition of the objectives, the macro fiscal objectives. We'll see that they are defined according to the strategic of national economic and social development. The resource envelope is defined by the revenue and the expenditures. The revenue, of course, comes from domestic resource mobilization. That is the funds that are gained from local taxes and local borrowing. And added to that is external financing, the grants and loans that may be obtained from sources outside of the national, the nation itself. The expenditures should include everything that government purchases, including wages. It's important that everything be on the budget, that there not be any secret budgets or off-budget activity. Now, if you look within that circle, you'll see that the national security strategy defines the security priorities, threats, and the full range of instruments needed, of the security instruments that are needed. Moving to number two is the whole process of budget preparation. But as Shannon Smith indicated today, there are critical dimensions of that preparation when we are discussing the security budget. The security budget preparation must include establishing laws and regulations to handle sensitive information, assign individuals who have been very carefully vetted to take on the additional responsibility. And when I was in government, I had to report all of my asset holdings, and these holdings were monitored on a regular basis since I had responsibility for operations that included millions of dollars, and also because some of the information related to the security of the United States. If we move on then to three, that is the execution of the budget, we keep in mind that in today's world, the execution has been aided by the digitization of much of our work and the use of information technology. We also have to keep in mind that the efficiency gains that come through that automation process actually carry with them potential risks. So all of those risks must be managed in a way that is consistent with maintaining the confidentiality of the process. Moving to the interior, when we discuss the budget for the security sector, we understand that in some cases, there will actually need to be confidential procurements that will require special procedures and be conducted by personnel with security clearance. However, the results of all that procurement and the way it's done should be available for oversight by the parliamentary committee that has the responsibility for monitoring the security sector budget. And so as you move through the cycles, oversight and monitoring and the evaluation of performance continue to be set within this framework of overall responsibility by the parliament when required by the law of that country, but conducted in a way that is consistent with maintaining the confidentiality and of the government objectives. So I've given just an overview of the role that Parliament can play in assuring that the security sector has the budget resources needed to meet the objectives of the national security strategy. And that is the important thing to keep in mind. Yes, I am an economist, and I'm always thinking, is that effective? Is that efficient? But the effectiveness and the efficiency are always set by the standards and the objectives that are contained in the national security strategy. As the representatives of the people, Parliament can mobilize a range of government resources to promote peace and prosperity. My colleague, Mr. Cole, will extend the analysis, and I look forward to your questions after his presentations. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That's a really helpful start here to our conversation. And I think that the illustration of the budget cycle is very useful, and particularly thinking about the security elements within that and the necessary issues there. I also take very much your point that you opened with, that members of parliament are uniquely placed to contribute to human security and to the importance of this role and the elements that go within it. We're now going to switch to Mr. Neil Cole. So Mr. Cole, over to you, please.
Thank you very much. And let me also join Dr. Johnson in saying that it is indeed an honor to have been invited to, I suppose, share some insights and share that with parliamentarians from the countries that points, and this is taken from really experience of working with the Parliament of South Africa, in particular the Budget Office and the Select Committee on Public Accounts, and also more recently work that we did with the National Assembly of Nigeria, and a training program where we were able to bring together members of public accounts committees, parliamentary budget officers, and also senior budget officials into a training program to look particularly at how the functioning of parliamentary budget offices are strengthened. So I'd like to start with an overview of just a couple of general points before getting into some of the detail. So next slide, please. I'm sure all of you are familiar with the opportunities that your constitutions provide for you to exercise parliamentary oversight. I'd like to suggest that there are informal opportunities as well. And when I present the budget process, which I won't go into too much detail because that's been covered quite adequately by Dr. Johnson, I will point out some of those informal opportunities. And this will be really taken from experience when I also needed to, as a senior budget official from the National Treasury of South Africa, needed to engage with Parliament. Oversight, and maybe this is an obvious point for those that are present, is that oversight should cover a budget formulation, in-year execution and expenditure outcomes. And I think in many jurisdictions, it is believed that the oversight of Parliament really only starts when the budget is tabled in Parliament by the executive. I want to propose that there are opportunities even before then. The time that is allocated for parliamentarians to undertake this oversight, especially when you have to consider the executive's budget proposals, is not always adequate, but there is a trade-off. So a shorter time spent in preparing the budget gives Parliament a little more time to evaluate the budget proposals, and the opposite is also true. We've looked at several examples in Africa of countries that provide more time for the evaluation of budget proposals, and those countries where an earlier budget policy proposal is presented, as in the case of South Africa is one example, where a medium-term budget policy is tabled, there is more time for Parliament to evaluate those proposals. With many countries now introducing reforms in the way that the budget is formulated and presented to Parliament, I think it is really up to Parliament to decide where they want to focus that oversight, right? So is it an oversight over the detailed items in the budget, or is it about looking at the programs, and is it about looking at the inputs versus the outputs and the outcomes? When Kenya tabled for the very first time their budget as a program-based budget to Parliament. So Parliament saw these programs, as an example, maternal health, and there were indicators that related to that program, and an overall allocation in terms of a new set of economic classifications. Parliament demanded that they want to see an itemized budget. They needed more information on the details of how the budget has been allocated, as opposed to the way that it was now being presented for the first time as a program-based budget. And then the last point I want to make here in the overview is that parliamentary budget officers have an important role or function to support the various parliamentary committees in evaluating, in assessing a budget, in that they are able to decipher some of the technical work that has gone into the assumptions that have been made leading to fiscal policy and leading to the budget decisions that have been taken. Just doing a scan in Africa of the capacity of the executive for the Ministry of Finance as opposed to the capacity of the Parliament. I mean, clearly, in many cases, the executive outranks, in terms of that capacity, Parliament's capacity, probably by a ratio of 1 to 10, maybe even 1 to 20. I recall my very first visit to the United States to attend a course at the Kennedy School. It was at the same time when the Enron hearings were being held by both the House and also the Senate. And I was just impressed by the knowledge that the parliamentarians were able to present, which matched the kind of details that the Enron bosses were presenting at the time of the hearings, and also the related characters that were involved in that scandal. If parliamentarians who obviously come from a wide range of backgrounds are going to be able to match that kind of insight that the executive has when they prepare the budget, the capacity of especially parliamentary budget officers will have to be improved. And we've done some my organization some work in that regard. Can we go to the next slide? So I don't want to go into any detail when it comes to the budget process, because in a different, slightly different diagram, Dr. Johnson elaborated on that, right? And it's essentially this five stages of budget formulation, the approval of the budget by the executive, the execution, once the authority is given to spend money, that's an execution by ministries, departments, and agencies. And then there's an accounting process that is undertaken that prepares financial statements for the audit, and in some cases now, a performance evaluation. What I do want to focus on is what is in orange and in green, where the orange color indicates those things in many jurisdictions that are the constitutional oversight that is performed by a parliament. And this may differ from a jurisdiction to jurisdiction, depending on either whether a more presidential system or parliamentary system is followed, and also if there is a more British legacy system in place as opposed to a French legacy system. On the statutory ones, on budget approval, there are the budget hearings that parliamentary committees undertake. And this is essentially looking at the appropriation, right? Because you are now required to vote on the appropriation. And depending on how the budget has been prepared, this can either be at a departmental level, or it can be one step lower than that, that looks at an appropriation or a vote to each of the programs that the budget has been prepared in. And this applies both to the main budget as well as the supplementary budget. And Dr. Johnson spoke quite a bit about amendments. And obviously now many parliaments now have amendment powers. Those amendment powers differ from parliament to parliament. Some parliaments are able to amend the budget where that amendment is restricted to shifting funds from one program to another or one vote to another. Other parliaments have greater powers that will affect the tax rate as well as affect the fiscal surplus or deficit. I always like to use the example of Nigeria, where President Buhari, when he was just appointed, the first budget that he had to prepare, he tabled that in Parliament. And Nigeria has the presidential system, and the National Assembly obviously did their thing. And when the budget was handed back to President Buhari, he said, "But I don't recognize this budget any longer." And that is because of the extent of the changes that had been made. And I suppose in presidential systems, that is often the case, as opposed to your parliamentary system, where your ruling party is also the party that has the majority in parliament. I think that the most important oversight role of parliament happens during the period when the budget is executed, which is, I suppose, 12 calendar months. And in order for parliament to do this, parliaments are either given monthly, quarterly, or annual reports. The monthly reports are obviously the ones that are preferred, because this really allows parliament to follow the performance of the ministries or departments and agencies that they are responsible for. And also they are able to pick up on cases of maladministration, fraud, corruption, and especially where this has been brought to light. I mean, Parliament in that in-year oversight has the possibility to do this. And we've certainly seen now in many jurisdictions with COVID-19 spending that parliaments have stepped in to conduct hearings where there have been cases of malfeasance. So that is what I refer to as hearings on government failures. And then there's the final stage of that oversight. And all that I really want to say here, because as Dr. Johnson went into quite a bit of detail, and that is the importance of ensuring that the recommendations that are made by Parliament and parliamentary committees, once they've received the Auditor General's report and have had hearings with their respective ministries, departments, and agencies, is to ensure that those recommendations are then taken into the next round of planning, right? And there are several indices that are in place. I mean, the one that I'm particularly fond of and thinking of at the moment is the Open Budget Index, that also looks at the extent to which the recommendations made by Parliament are taken into the next planning cycle. Next slide, please. So let me run very quickly through this list of documents. I spoke about the Open Budget Index. And the Open Budget Index suggests that the following 8 documents have to be prepared by the executive and tabled in Parliament alongside the tabling of the budget. And where countries are able to do so, the information that is provided to the legislator is then considered to be substantive, right? And this is the main macroeconomic assumptions that underpin the fiscal policy objectives for the medium term, and many countries have now moved towards a medium-term expenditure framework. Then where a country does undertake a medium-term expenditure framework for the budget to indicate what the estimates of expenditure are over the 3 years, especially the 2 out years in particular. And then there's the framework that covers at least the total revenues, total expenditure, and then financing for general government in addition to central government. Many countries are now also tabling non-financial performance targets linked to each of the programs. And these would come in the form of measurable objectives, targets, indicators, et cetera. Estimate cost of new policies proposed in the budget, very important. And then, which I suppose fewer countries table, and that is the fiscal sensitivity analysis of the macroeconomic assumptions. And included in that often is what would be the intergenerational impact of the borrowing strategy that a government may undertake. And then there's the comprehensive table of tax expenditures. Next slide, please. And this will be my last slide, because I'm sure that there has to be adequate time for questions and discussion. Let me end by looking at 2 useful tools that parliamentarians can use in order to improve on not only the oversight, but the inputs that they have into planning and also the preparation of spending plans. The first is the medium-term expenditure frameworks. And this is essentially 3-year rolling spending plans, in the sense that the 2 outer years then become the first and the second year, and so on and so on. And what it essentially does is, during the planning and the preparation of the medium-term expenditure framework, what the executive is doing is that it is matching aggregate fiscal frameworks with the spending plans that are presented by MDAs. Now, if one was to only focus on 1 year, being the year that is to be appropriated, the time to do that is very limited, in the sense that one can say that the horse has already bolted, right? So the executive has put a lot of work in preparing that 1 year annual budget, and the extent to which a thorough examination can be taken or amendments undertaken are quite limited. Whereas what the medium-term expenditure framework allows Parliament to do is to also look at those two outer years that are being tabled, right? Because those two outer years, depending on how well the MTF is prepared, allows Parliament a window into what the executive's thinking is in year two and year three, right? So is the executive planning to, let me use an example from social development, is the executive planning to expand on a child support grant, for instance, in year two and year three? Well, Parliament therefore then has several more months to examine that new plan. And finally, it allows for that matching of plans, budgets, and reports. And then there's program and performance-based budgets. And this is essentially, as I said, preparing the budget according to a set of programs within each of the ministries. And an example of a program could be land forces or air forces, could be broken up into several sub-programs. Peacekeeping could be located either within each of those or a program all on its own. And it therefore allows Parliament to then start to examine not only the program based on a policy priority, but also what is the total of the allocation that has been made to that program, and then what are the allocations made to the various economic classifications. It sets out, if it's well done, quite nicely objectives, indicators, and targets. Sometimes too many indicators are used, too many targets are used. And you know, when you try to do too much, you often do nothing. So the number of indicators and targets are very important. And I suppose the two last points for me are the most important ones when it comes to program-based budgeting. And that is that it locates accountability with the program manager, right? So now you know who the person is that is the program manager to which an allocation has been made and who is responsible for spending that allocation in accordance with whatever prescripts may be in place. And they're really good, slogan that goes with program budgeting is that it allows the manager to manage, but holds her accountable for all aspects of the performance of the program in respect of the funds that have been allocated and also the mandate of the program. So I think these are really two useful tools for parliamentarians. The one gives Parliament a longer horizon that it can look at when we're not only doing the immediate oversight, but also having an input into what the spending plan looks like in year two and year three. And then program budgeting allows Parliament to really start to examine how the executive is delivering on its policy priorities according to a set of programs and the matching of that with a budget allocation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I feel like I'm in a masterclass on budget cycles and understanding the mechanisms and the need for revision. I guess before we open it up to sort of more general questions, and I hope everyone is thinking about them, I'd like to take the privilege of posing a couple questions to you. And I'd like to start with, if either of you were a member of Parliament yourselves, and you had an upcoming hearing with senior officials and you wanted to talk about security spending, what are the key types of questions that you would ask?
Dr. Johnson, it's always the case for...
I always think it's very important that we understand what we mean by security. And certainly there are a few countries in Africa that actually do village and community level surveys of that. And so I'd be very interested to know what the perception is, or can you give me some objective indicators to show what the current state of security is, perceived security, relative to where it was when we started this budget cycle. In other words, are we making a difference? Are we moving in the right direction? If we are not, what have been the threats that might not have been anticipated that have led to this deterioration? Or, and this is the case that has happened all too often recently, why is it that we weren't able to provide the needed material, the needed trained personnel that would have been required to make progress in the area of security? So that's, I would like to hear an assessment of what has happened and why. What are the factors that may have contributed to that? I really liked what Mr. Cole was saying about the medium-term framework, because it allows us to look forward. So we're always, we're never just looking at a point in time, even though we may be examining a particular month or moment. We always have that perspective. So I think that's that. If I were a parliamentarian, that might be what I would ask about. Objective indicators, I always like them.
If I was a parliamentarian, and I sometimes wonder if that's where I will be spending the last of my years working as a parliamentarian. But what sometimes turns me away from pursuing that thought is that I would first have to join a political party, but not said to offend anyone. I have a condition before setting out a couple of questions, and that is that when the department or ministry appears before Parliament, I think the committee should ensure, and I would certainly make sure that the representation from the ministry is at the appropriate level, because sometimes fairly junior officials are sent to Parliament, and it's a way of not answering the questions that are being asked, because then a whole series of deferments then happen. So as a parliamentarian, I would insist that the right level of seniority appears before the committee. A question that a budget related question that I would ask is, when you presented your spending plans, and this relates to spending plans and annual reports, I would ask, when you presented your spending plans, you clearly did not receive all the money that you were asking, because the budget is about trade-offs. And when a new allocation was made, did you make the adjustments in your plan for the allocation that had been made? And this is a question that covers several responses that are going to be made later on in the year. And that is, when Parliament would ask any ministry why they were unable to deliver on their plans, the answer to that is often, we did not receive adequate funding to do that. And in some respects, that is a bit of a nonsense response, because by the time a budget is passed, every plan should have been funded, right? There may be occasions where in-year adjustments would need to be made, maybe because of an economic downturn or a natural or man-made disaster. But the excuse that we did not get enough money cannot be the correct response, because there's a plan and there's a budget, and plans and budgets have to always be aligned. So I would never accept a response to my question, why were you not able to deliver on your objectives? I would never accept an answer that says we did not have sufficient funding. Thanks.
Thank you. So in your responses just now and in your presentations earlier, both of you have drawn some very useful connections to sort of the longer horizon or the midterm horizon. Dr. Johnson spoke to the importance of a national security strategy as the underpinnings, the structure around which policies and budgets are built. And Mr. Cole, you spoke about you know, sort of the near term and the medium and longer term budget forecasting and then understanding sort of in, you know, as you said, that a minister comes before you asking about this alignment with plans and budgeting and therefore also with the plans and the larger strategy that preceded them. What if we then looked at further out the chain of spending so that you know, the budget has been passed, spending is underway, and the minister comes back for another hearing. What are the types of questions or even beyond a hearing, what are the sort of investigatory questions or the lines of thought that either of you might pursue in thinking about then monitoring the allocation of funds and how the money is actually spent?
I think the allocation of funds is actually one of the most important elements in the assessment of performance. And I say that because as an economist, we think of allocative efficiency. And the allocative efficiency is not just in a vacuum. It's always within a context. So if someone is coming to me, the executive is coming saying, I must increase spending in this area. What, from a budgetary perspective, we still have a defined objective outcome. I would have to look at other parts of the budget to see how they may be reinforced by different elements so that we can still have our overall desired outcome. And that may not always be possible, but I do think it's very important to always have the overall outcome as the criteria that one is using to assess. It's not, did I get to the end of that road, but it is, where is my entire team relative to that objective? And so we'd have to think of how you can substitute or how you can change the timing of deploying, or in many cases, how you can increase the skills in a certain area. The most important thing in any government is the people who are doing the work. And if you can increase the training or adjust it in a certain way, you might be able to compensate for a lack of funds going into that area. So the important thing for me would be to look at the overall, not just intertemporally, to look at the time dimension, but also to see how all the pieces of the puzzle put together. I often think of this as a kaleidoscope, you know, that the many colored pieces that children look through what looks like a telescope. And the fact is that if you just turn that a little bit, you have a whole different picture. And so I think that once you've turned it, you need to study that picture again, see how the pieces fit together, and see how that new structure moves you towards meeting your strategic objective.
Thanks. So there's clearly, I mean, especially in the response from Dr. Johnson, I think what it points to is the need for Parliament in exercising that oversight to decide on what it wants to look at, right? Because it's not going to be able to look at everything. And one way to trick Parliament into not looking at the things that they are required to look at is to also bombard Parliament with just too much detail. So if Parliament says, yes, we're very interested, as Dr. Johnson has pointed out, that it wants to focus on that outcomes, overall performance, and how things fit together, then examining very closely the performance of programs would be a useful way to get there. Because then questions about how we're spending it appears to be going very slowly in this quarter, and this is what your plan says you're meant to be doing in that quarter. So what is going on? And the answer invariably is not going to be about, we were unable to procure pencils. The answer, especially if it's a very senior representation, and as you say, the minister, the response is going to be a discussion or a dialogue about the performance of a program. So if it is about peacekeeping, I mean, then the discussion can be about peacekeeping that is taking place and a particular country's participation in those peacekeeping forces, as opposed to just too much details that there may be a temptation to get into, but that may also result in not looking at the bigger picture, as Dr. Johnson has already pointed out. So I think program budgeting is really useful in that respect. And it allows for that connect between the performance of the program, the overall outputs, and then how that is then contributing towards the outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think that's an excellent transition point here, that this emphasis on it's not spending for spending's sake, but it's toward a particular outcome. It's toward goals. And then evaluating progress toward those goals. So this has been really fruitful and rich. Thank you. And we're nearing at the end of our appointed time. So I'll just make a few concluding remarks and a couple technical announcements, but start by thanking our speakers, Mr. Neil Cole and Dr. William Johnson, for a really terrific and rich discussion. We have got new insights into the budget cycle, the context of human security, and into the importance of these issues, that this is a really, this is a roadmap to accountability. These are really fundamental questions for any government. But I also really appreciated some of the practical counsel that we've received, particularly about the emphasis on needing indicators, understanding what you're measuring, and making some choices as an individual, as a member of parliament or staff. You cannot be an expert in all things, but at the same time, you want your government to be telling you what their indicators for success are, and then asking them if they're meeting them, asking where what are the assessments of progress. And often the security questions that governments are facing are extraordinarily difficult. And you may not see success in this particular budget cycle, but you still have to ask the question, and you have to ask why, because then it gets to these bigger issues that strategies underlie budgets, and you want to know, does one need to adapt? Because the fundamental issue is, how do expenditures advance security? Ask the executive branches, how can you tell they're advancing security? What are your underlying goals, and how are you programming toward them, and how are you making progress in that direction? And these are the kind of questions we are all asking of our officials, and they are legitimate, and they are part of the public domain. We've also gotten some insights then into the how to separate, what is truly confidential from what needs to be part of public discourse. And there are some mechanisms to do that, including creating, sort of vetting staff and others. But again, let me thank our speakers. Let me thank our terrific interpreters and everyone else who made this program possible, and look forward to seeing you in discussion groups tomorrow, and then for our final week of plenary and discussion next week. Thank you and farewell.